we are going to laminate a CD103 AirLock with a CD103 AF Alignable connector. These are the package that you will receive when you order this. All your components should be in it. And we'll put aside the things we don't need and keep the things that we will. Our cast already has an anchor on it, so we won't need that. Set that aside. Here's the most important part of the package, the fabrication instructions. Most people would believe that, but it is true. And we'll get our Align 4 out here. All the things that we need and don't need. Okay, so in our laminating process, we are going to transfer our alignment. So what we'll need to do first, just like we follow through here in our instructions, is take our Align 4, put our glue plate on it, which is what this is for, and we'll put a pyramid on and set that up in our transfer jig. We'll fill this with Coyote Quick. We'll have our lock on the end of our cast, and we'll set it down and transfer. So, just like our instructions say, it doesn't hurt to lubricate things a little bit. We're using the Compound 4. We get that from Cascade. Stick wax works. Petroleum jelly, just a light coating, works for a mold release. Just put a real light coat on there. And all this does is make it release from the glue a little easier. It will not stick to the Coyote Quick, but it just pops off a little easier. It keeps you from prying on things after you have it all glued together on your cast. We'll set that on there. Put our pyramid on. These are the four screws that are provided. They should be M6 by 18. You'll find that 20s are too long. The chamber for our connectors are all designed to hold an 18. Millimeter screw. And then in our instructions, it shows taking the lock and placing it on the end of the cast and setting it down into your alignment and gluing it into place. And then it shows taking everything away from your transfer jig and placing it back on top of your cast with a PVA bag. The one step I'm going to do a little different here is while I'm getting my parts prepped, instead of leaving my lock together with a button and everything inside of it, it actually goes on to the anchor easier if your components are removed from the lock. So while I'm prepping everything together, I like taking out my lock plate and all the mechanism and get them out of there right now. And then I'd like to take a little bit of Compound 4 and rub it around my O-ring here. Just a precautionary to make sure I get a real nice seal. It's an old rule of thumb when you're laminating and you have things that have to come apart, you probably want to lubricate them a little. And then you just bring that down snug. You don't have to torque into it. You can see that O-ring just seats in there real nice. It doesn't pooch out around the tooling or dummy piece. So now we have a perfect seal here. All right, we're ready to move over to the transfer jig. Orientation, the reason why I bring that up is knowing if it's left or right, making sure you're getting your release button placed the direction you want it to go. Atypical is medial, but we've also done people that ride horses, motorcycles, and we've set that button lateral. I've actually seen it where a geriatric patient, we put it straight anterior. And so you want to make sure you're getting this orientation where you want it. So we have a left leg here, so I'm going to place my lever release button on our medial side. And we'll set that on there nice and snug. And then we'll drop it down into transfer here. So we have our lock where we're liking the looks of it. Got a nice medial line flowing here. We've been transferred. We have everything back in the neutral. And all we have to do now is just drop it down and see what we've got. And that looks great. And as you can see, in our transfer, The nice thing about the connector and the lock working together is you can get this little bit of outset or forward placement of your socket compared to your foot. This is what we had set up on the patient, so now I'm going right back to the same alignment that they had before in their check socket. We haven't changed anything on them. We have a good fit, and now we have a good alignment. It's all in neutral. So now we've got everything set up where we want it. We'll take our Coyote Quick, and we will fill in the void in our connector. I try to lay that in there without leaving any open areas. Okay. Now we'll drop everything back into place. We're sitting in there good. A little bit of excess, we'll just wipe that away. And as soon as that sets up, we're ready to remove it and continue on with our lamination, which takes roughly, what, 3 or 4 minutes with Coyote Quick. The way I'm going to laminate today, I'm going to actually take my cast away and put my PVA bag on it. Then I'm going to take my lock and my transferred component and put them back on top of my cast. So I'm going to come over here to my medial side where my release button is. I'm going to look down the center of my release button tooling and just mark my cast like so. So now after I put my PVA back on, I'll set my lock and my transferred component right back where it belongs, and then I'll glue it on. So in this application, we're going with a raw cast just to line up our lock to our transfer. We'll take this back out, our cast back out, put a PVA bag on it, then we'll glue our lock and set it back on top and make sure we're in the correct orientation, and we'll still be in a good transfer. Another way of doing this would be to put your PVA bag on your cast first, glue your lock on where you want it, then put it back in the transfer jig and set it down into your connector, which works great. The method I'm doing today, the nice part about it is I'm not handling my PVA bag and having to keep manipulating it with my hands and possibly tear it. So what will have happen is our cast will be in our vacuum bench and we'll put our bag on and glue everything on without having to handle a cast with a PVA bag on it. Both ways work great. We're just going to do it this application, which is what we also show in our instructions. Our glue is set up good enough. Now we're ready to take everything apart. This is something I wanted to show as a tech tip. If I had my PVA bag on and I was glued to my lock, instead of just unhooking here and taking everything with the pyramid, I like to, while it's in a locked position, a solid position, I like to loosen up my screws on my pyramid to my connector, because everything's nice and solid right now. And I have seen where a technician has had those screws so tight on that pyramid going into his connector that when he took it off and had it ready to vacuum, cranking on those, he actually broke loose his lock to his PVA bag and he had to re-glue everything back on. So sometimes it's a good idea to go ahead and start loosening everything up before you take it apart. Now we have our transfer in place. Once we get our bag on, we'll turn right around and then we'll glue and set our lock on. But we'll take this back over here. Got our cast back out of the jig. We're ready to release our glue plate. And this is why you want to lube it up a little bit. Just take a screwdriver, maybe even a utility knife, anything you can just get underneath there and make it pop loose. And this one came right off really easy. So now, where are we at in our steps here? We're ready to glue our lock back onto our cast in alignment, as long as we match up our mark that we made on our cast. The only downside I see to doing a transfer like this, where you remove everything, is the potential of rotation change. But if you get that back on your mark where it belongs, it's going to be so minimal, it won't matter. The upside to this is now we can pull our PVA bag over our cast and get it tied off like we're going to do next, and we don't have to manhandle this bag in and out of a transfer jig, because I have broken, everybody's broken a PVA bag, but just the handling of that in a transfer jig can cause it to break. Our cast is acetated, it's all nice and sealed and ready to go. The first thing we do before the PVA bag is I'll put on a sheer vacuum nylon, something really super thin, just to help the PVA bag slide on. You certainly don't have to do that. A little bit of looseness right here is what we want. We want to get this excess nylon out of our way. So I'm just going to take some standard thread and tie it off. Down here we have a nice little groove where you can tie off to. So we'll just spin this dirty around here, get a hold of that. And now we'll get rid of this. We don't want this around our post. It just makes the lock fit on a lot harder, and it's not designed for all that bulk to be in there. Nip this off pretty close, because next we'll have a PVA bag on there, and we don't want to start getting a bunch of buildup in here, causing it to be hard for our lock to seat on, because this O-ring right here is made to be a seal in the perfect spot in this lock. So if resin passes around here and tries to go up in that lock chamber, that O-ring will stop it. So you want to make sure you have a real nice seal there. Okay, so what we have to bear in mind now is getting this bag on here as snug as we can, our distal end, because we don't want to have any webbing from our bag outside of our lock edge, because it will show up in your lamination and it just looks bad. We're already getting close. Now we've got our bag on here. Let's go ahead and warm it and stretch it out a little bit so it really seals nice around that anchor edge. I pull up on the bag, some tension, run my heat gun around it, basically making heat shrink out of it. Toughen it up a little. And as soon as you relax that bag, you can just see how it draws in up around that anchor really nice. Now, we want to take our string and tie in that same place. Get that right in that groove. There we go. A couple of quick knots. We'll get rid of this flagging that we've got here because that could interfere with our lock going on. Just run it up there close. Okay, we'll double check our ring. Wrinkles inside of that ring, no big deal. Wrinkles out here, that's what you're going to see. It's outside of the area of the lock. This was the step I was talking about, where if you did a transfer and you glued your lock on and then took it with a PVA bag over to your transfer jig and set it in alignment, works just great. It's just you're moving and handling your bag. Now, we have a transferred plate on here. All we need to do is put glue on and then just line this back up, and we're in alignment that's perfectly acceptable. Run a bead on the outside edge of the lock, and I get calls occasionally on doing this step, and guys are afraid that this glue will stick to that lock. It will not. It'll stick to this PVA bag, but it won't stick to the lock. But it will bond it to where it won't move while you're laminating, so it will hold still in that position. Now before it sets up, get rid of the excess, if you have any. Just hold it steady in place for a couple of seconds, and that'll set right up. Now if you have a big, just an enormous amount of glue coming out there, go ahead and wipe it off, and if you need to, take your acetone, put a little on your rag, and you can go right around that edge and get that bulk excess off without it busting your PVA bag. And then you'll have a really nice clean inside of your socket. You won't have any roughness or glue tracing. That's just nice and clean around there. Just makes a perfect little seal. We'll let that set up for a minute. We'll start putting our layup on. One other thing we want to do just before we do our layup, we might as well put some clay in that hole. If it fills up with resin, just one more thing to deal with down the road. So just put a touch of clay in there. And because I am laminating over it, I'm going to take a little of my compound 4 and just lightly coat it, staying away from the body of my lock. I want that lamination to seal around that lock, but I don't want it to seal around that real hard. If you skip that, it's not a big deal. It will still come out. Just makes it a little easier down the road, just like using the glue plate and putting a little bit on it. Okay, so for our layup that we're doing with our AirLock, we're going to lay this up the same thing that we advertise when we sell our Coyote Composite. We have a suggested layup sheet, or recipe sheet if you call it that, for things that we do and we've tried that work for a standard layup. What I'm going to have is 2 flex of stretch to start with, 2 nylon stockinette, and then I'm going to put on 2 Coyote Composites. I'll have a reinforcement piece in the mix in here over the ends of the distal end of my lock, and my connector, and that will be what we're going to call a standard layup with modified acrylic resin. Today we're going to use the Nano Resin from Axis, and that gives us a real nice standard layup. Lightweight, durable, 90% of your layups can be in this fashion if you prefer to go this method. If we go heavier, then we just increase the layers that we're looking at, whether it be stockinette, whether it be the composite. If we want to go lighter, you start removing the stockinette and keep your two layers of composite. So that way you have two full layers over your distal end holding your connector on and your lock. Having double layers over that is really a key. It just makes sure you're going to be super strong on the end of your socket. So now we're on the layup section, and we're going to go very, very close to what it shows on there. And your layup can vary. So let's pull over our flex-a-stretch and then reflect it. Now, on the Align 4, this is kind of a key. When you twist and reflect and pull that back around, you don't want to keep turning it till you make this huge knot, because those knots are going to start building up in between your four posts. And as that builds up, it just makes that taller and taller and taller until you have problems getting your lamination plate on, which is last. So the idea here is to do your layup and stay within the confines of this thickness. Now, if you have to do a heavier lamination where you're going to be outside of that, then at some point where you're still level, you can put this on and then still do layups over the top of the lamination plate. You'll just have to sand down to the plate before you remove it, and you'll still have a nice flat surface on the bottom of your limb. You'll just have more material built up in a circle around it. So we want to just give that a nice twist. And when I reflect back, what I'm trying to do is cover my post, but yet leave a little dead surface right there in the center, so I know I'm not building this up right over the top. So what we're looking at is not getting a bunch of heavy buildup right here. We'll end up with two nylons and then a couple of composites. That's getting a lot of layers over the end of this, and you get too much, and it just makes it kind of difficult. Now we've got those two on. In our instructions, it states that you can use a hot awl to punch through your nylons, or you can nip them. Typically, I take my dental pick or an awl, especially on this first layer with the flex-a-stretch, and I just give it a couple of pokes and lift it and move it, and it just lays right around it just like that. It goes right over it. Another trick, poke it in there and just nip it a little bit. Oop, my scissors were sharper. There we go. And it drops right over. But you have to get that material out of that hole and around that post. There we go. I just poke it a few times. Oh, that one's being a stiff on me, so we'll just do this. Just like that, and we're good. One other thing you can do, and it's also stated in our manual, you're going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 layers over the top of your dummy tooling. And this bridging area is things we talk about when we laminate. It's always a bad thing when you have lots of spring-loaded bridges in there, because that's where air likes to develop as it tightens down and it relaxes. Because this is doing nothing for us but making the inside of our socket smooth, there's nothing structural about this. I'm going to take and get rid of some of this material right around my tooling. And that does two things for me. One is it stops that bridge and all this buildup we don't need. And it also brings this in closer to the lock edge right here, so we're not creating a bridge at the base of our lock. If I start bridging really stiff inside here, I will take my thread before I get my composite on. I'll lay on all my layers of nylon and stockinettes. And if it's really bridging and it's hard to push it in there, I'll take my thread and tie it off just like we did earlier on the PVA bag and draw that in as close as I can. The closer, the tighter everything is when you laminate, the better. A lot less chance for air. Because what happens on these nylons is they spring out when they're being laminated, and if you don't have huge pools of resin to keep that together, you try stringing it out hard, it'll pull away and then you'll get air inside there. Okay, so we have that on. We're gonna go with our two layers of nylon stockinette, which is just a 3-inch nylon. The amazing thing about this stuff is it's very durable, and it makes a real nice finishing edge when you clean up your socket and sand it down. And for as inexpensive as it is and as durable as it is, it makes a nice additive. Okay, so we've got it reflected. Make a little bit of a circle in the middle again. Pull it down nice and snug. Now the nylon, the all heated up with a torch, works really well to burn through it because it's a little thicker material. But you don't always have a torch handy. And when you don't, just get a little section of it, nip it with your scissors, and fish it right around there. Just so those posts are nice and exposed. You want it, when I mean nip it, I'm talking you just take a little bit of it. Because if you cut a great big hole, it'll start running and you'll have a run down the side and you don't want that. Especially if this is a finish, say a Caucasian or a lamination with color in it, a solid color. You can't have your nylons running. This lamination, we're doing our nylons first and then our braid so we can see the braid on the outside. If I was doing a Caucasian or a solid color pigment, I would do my coyote braid first and then finish with nylon stockinette and flex a stretch to make a nice smooth outer finish. Same material, just opposite layup. Sharp my scissors again. There we go. Just push that around it. Okay, so this leg isn't bad for bridging right here. Just a little bit. You know what? Good rule of thumb. I'm going to go ahead and tie that in a little tighter because it certainly can't hurt. That designed for that old O-ring that we used, and that makes a perfect groove to tie that in and get it nice and snug all down the side of that body of the lock. Great. Now we're ready for our two layers of Coyote Composite. Let's just check our end here. We still have lots of room there to go with. Okay, so I'll take our first layer and slip it around, cover up my distal. I've got just enough here at the top. This is going to work out just right. So take a little spray glue. So we'll just hold that where we know we want it. We'll just give it a little mist so it stays in place. Bring that right up around everything. It draws in there real nice. Okay, so on this first one, you can mesh everything down and then take your tool and pick around it to expose your holes for your line four, or you can take your scissors and just cut straight down each side of where that's at and then cut it off right at the base. So we'll swing around to this one. I'm just going to cut straight down each side of the hole, each side of my screw hole, and then right across. And the only reason why I'm doing this is so it just keeps more material from building up on my distal end that I don't need. It won't change my strength value of my connector being secured on my leg. Give it just a touch of spray glue, keep everything together. We'll just lay that right in between those posts. And so as you lay these in there, I like to try to get them to match up right in my middle and not overlap too far, because then you start doing that and it starts making that buildup in the center real heavy. So I'm just laying that to where they're coming together in the middle. All the rest of it's just overkill after that. All right, so this is where the release button is, and that composite comes together and kind of makes a pucker. I just split it right down the middle of it and then lay those over together just like that. Now, if your layup at this point is getting too thick on top, that's where our instructions talk about taking your lamination plate and putting it on, and then putting on any final layers you may want to put on and tying them off right there. So that way when you're done, you can still pop this off. You'll just be bigger around here. You won't be thicker on top. Okay, now we'd like to take some carbon tape. This is just for reinforcement purposes. We lay it right through there and come up onto your socket, however far you think you need, depending on the activity level. This is kind of a just in case thing to do. A little shot of spray glue, put that right between the posts. Lay it down there on the leg. There we go. Now where our lock is, what we'll do is flare it around it. Where our release button's gonna go. Piece back on, go down our lateral side, and then as you come around you can twist it whichever direction, forward, backward of the leg, anterior, posterior, whatever. I'm just going to swing it around like that so we can still sand this off, and we've got our little reinforcement area there. Now if you want, if you're really trying to make that look sleek, you could take your scissors and cut away some of the face of where that tooling is and even make that thinner. But two layers of composite only over the face of that tooling piece isn't much, and it does make a real nice edge. The more buildup you get on the front of it as you sand away, the more of it you see on the outside edge, and it makes it look real thick and heavy and sanded. So the more of the material you get rid of, the nicer, cleaner, thinner edge that looks right around it. Okay, so since we're still doing good on top here, I am going to lay this next layer on and cut it the same way and overlap it. And we should be just right for thickness. On this limb, I'm using a 5-inch braid, which seems to be coming out just about right. A 6 would have been okay on them. It just makes the distal end a little thicker. Okay. The other thing nice about spray glue when you touch it like that is it helps keep from fraying. And I was actually on the ends, and I was shown that by a technician a long time ago, back when we were using carbon, because it used to just fray and go crazy on the ends, and I hated it because you play with it too much when you first start doing this, and it just made a mess. So same thing. I'm just cutting a slot right where my mount hole's going to go. And you could certainly lay all of it over and then take your tool and move the braid out of the way. Okay, so these tabs I have are a little bit longer than my last ones. And as you can see, they're laying way over in the middle. So I'm going to go ahead and shorten these up just a little bit, because I don't need all that material hanging over that socket in the center of it. It's as strong as it's going to get. As soon as it comes up and crosses over the ledge of that, you're done. That's as strong as that thing is going to be. There. Just do a touch more so it'll stay down. We'll just fold those in. We're sitting right on top of that little carbon strip that we put on there. Oh, that's beautiful. That's going to be nice and level. It just lays in there so pretty. All right. Now we're ready for our lamination plate. We're drawing in good. It's just our braid, which will conform into that wonderfully. We'll put our lamination plate on. I'll use my compound 4. Put a little bit of lube on each one of my screws because I'm laminating and I don't like to play with resin on moving parts. And you've done many, many laminations without doing that, and I've done many, many with it. And it's just a habit. It's hard to break. They just come in and out so much smoother. So now we want to seat this down in kind of a star pattern. We don't want to overcrank one side more than another because we do have layers on there. It's trying to compress down. So now I'm going around and hitting each one, and I'm not killing them. I'm just bringing them down there nice and snug. I know we're going to get full depth out of our screw. There we go, just like that. Not honking on it. If you go take and really crank on that with a wrench, you take the chance of taking your glue and unhooking it from your PVA bag, and then you've lost your rotation. Okay, so got those put in. And one other thing I started doing a long time ago, which makes it a whole lot easier, is I have a hole. I'm going to put a little bit of clay in it. I don't like digging resin out of screws. And if I do this right, these screws will be perfect to reuse. All right, so at this point, let's say you have a fabric you need to put on this. This is a real good place to set this up and leave it, and now take your fabric, if you can do it in this manner, and bring it around it, or pull it over it if you've sewn it, and then take your string and do just what our instructions talk about for a layer of your braid, and then catch right underneath that lip and bring this around and string tie it, and then get rid of some of the waste and sort of leave the fabric stay up here. And then when you pull your PVA bag, you've got your fabric tied off nice and snug right here, and it won't move on you. And you can do a string lamination without having your material move. And then when you go to take this plate off, you'll have a just perfect little edge right here, and none of this will show. Your fabric will come right up underneath as you draw it in, because you can see how that string draws up underneath that plastic plate onto those metal posts. And that's just what that fabric will do. It'll just tuck right up in there, and it'll come right around the socket and just stop. And it looks really nice when you're done. So before I pull my PVA bag, which you can certainly pull right over the top of the braid, one more thing I like to do is a sheer vacuum nylon again, because it just makes it easier for pulling the bag over, and it's 99% unnoticeable on the outside of the socket. Where are we at in our steps? We've got our layup done. We've got our lamination plate on, and my PVA bag's about ready. I put a sheer nylon vacuum stockinette on just to make it easier to pull my PVA bag over my leg, and we're ready to rock and roll. All right, that looks good. Plenty tight enough. The seam's laying nice and flat. So I've got our bag on. I went ahead and lightly powdered it. Some people like using silicone. Check our vacuum. We've got good vacuum draw, and that's one of the things I want to mention right now, is that I'm using a modified acrylic resin, which is thinner than the epoxy resins, and we lower our vacuum down to about 15 pounds to laminate with. This has been a real good key for some people who say they have trouble stringing it out and getting dry on their edges. They're overstringing and they're thinning it out too much. So drop your vacuum down. That'll help aid in your overstringing and getting dry areas in your lamination. Let's mix up our resin, and we'll put just a little bit of blue pigment in it today. We'll see what Coyote Composite braid looks like with blue pigment in it. And I'm going to mix this right by the manufacturer's recommendations. It says right on the bottle, 3% hardener, 2% pigment. Right there, 3%. The pigment's a little tougher to measure because of the way it's set up, but it's not too tough. I'll get some on my stick here. This is an ultra blue we get from Cascade. I'll stir that in. 2% of the ultra blue would really be strong. You can see my hardener, little white dots in it mixing up. Yeah, that looks nice. That'll be a nice blue on that. Plenty dark enough. Kick our vacuum on. Yeah, see, at 15 pounds, that's drawn down on that bag plenty. And on these thinner resins, it does work well to lower your vacuum. It just, the potential for starving out is much lower. Okay, now with our epoxy resins, we run at full vacuum, which is 23, 24, 25 pounds. And that works really well with the real thick, heavy epoxies. But these thinner modifieds, it's too much. And if you string it all too hard and you've drawn too much and it doesn't set up quick enough, it would be easy to dry any lamination out. I don't care if it's composite, if it's fiberglass, if it's carbon, it would be really easy to dry them out. So at the very beginning of this, you have that hole in the center of your five-hole lamination plate. Go ahead and let that saturate. Don't get in a big hurry right here to rush this full of resin, because you can create air pockets in there, especially if you didn't do some of what we talked about, and that was stringing things and getting it nice and tight up around your lock. So at the very beginning of this, I introduce it and kind of work it over and just see if I'm getting everything saturated good. Especially right up there at the top, you have all those layers laying on top of each other. And that looks great. No air bubbles, nothing. It's drawn fine. Plenty of draw. Everything's soaked down good. That's doing great. Now there's a good example of that right there, if the film would show it. You push underneath where that button is and pull it away super hard, and you could see that nylon try to move, and it made a dry spot in there. It made air in there. Whatever it was, we moved it along. When you do a layup around a leg and you use a lock, I don't think sometimes we really realize how many layers, how thick this is compared to where it is here. Out here it's all spread out wide. Up here it's all pulled together really tight. And the way that lock sits on there, that holds a lot of resin up around it, especially right there at the edge where it curls away. I'm just using a parachute string. I'm not pushing real hard. All right, so the other thing I'm doing is I'm bringing this down so far and my pulling and quitting. I'm not running it right clear over the edge of the socket. Just bring it down and stop. And keep working all this thick area out, which also helps keep from starving. Let your vacuum do some of that work right there. Now, right before it sets up, that's the last thing I do, is run it out over the edge. Even with this modified acrylic, I'm gonna warm this up a little bit. String it one more time. Got to get that excess out of the end of this thing. So I'd like to have a little bit more on my proximal edge. One little thing you can do, you don't have to do this, but sometimes when you run some tape around there, it helps push out excess resin. Just do it carefully, you won't get wrinkles in your bag. And that's already setting up. We're done playing with it. We'll just leave that alone and come back to it in half an hour and cut her up. Okay, we're done laminating. Now we can cut it out. We'll cut it out close to our trim line. I'll get the lamination cap off the end, open up the dummy tooling, take it out, and then we'll pull it on our socket puller. Tape lines aren't even showing. You don't have a huge amount of buildup here. Just take a screwdriver and tap it off. Or you take it over to your sander and sand it down to the surface of the plastic. Knock that off. All we've got is that one little vacuum nylon across the top of this. And if you remember right, put just a teeny bit of clay in each one of those. Those are all pretty. There's no resin in our holes. And that lube makes those come out of there much nicer. Screws aren't damaged. We can actually reuse those. And you just catch in between where your posts are. Give that a little tap. Comes right off. That's all there is to that. This edge here, it's just one layer of nylon and a teeny bit of resin, so you can easily take your Troutman to that and buff the edge, make it smooth so it's not sharp. That's the post right where the center was of our lamination plate. Take your sander and hit it. Just like that. We'll knock our clay out of there. We'll unscrew that. Just like that. You can look down inside that lock. You see no resin in there. You can see in there it's nice and clean. We've got a good edge to work with here too. It's not real thick and wide. A real nice edge. Okay, if we can get some light in there, you can see how nice inside of that looks. And a Coyote Quick didn't stick to it for a lock. Have a really nice edge. There's no glue making anything, you know, rough or hard edge in there. You can see right there is where all the Coyote Quick is at, how it bonded to that PVA bag. So on some things when you're laminating, having the Coyote Quick is nice to have just to glue things onto your PVA bag because you know it'll stay put. Let's sand her down closer to our lines. So I ran my first edge with a rough cone, trying to get my lines all straight. And then drop down to a finer sanding cone. Ran my inside and outside edge just to get kind of a roll. Now I'll go to my green Scotch-Brite, put her on slow, and just work it across that edge, just like if I was doing it by hand. This is a pretty beat up cone, and they run them a long time. If you do it on slow, you'll keep from putting all these grooves in it. And then drag it the center of the cone away from it. From the middle out of the outside edge. The nice part about being on slow, you don't get in a big toot. Let it run on that thing. It's just dulling it up. There's two layers of stockinette on the inside really make a nice leading edge, even the outside edge though. We'll work the edge of this over a little bit. And what the heck, make that nice and soft so a technician or a practitioner gets a hold of it and they won't have anything rough. we put blue pigment in it. You can tell because the inside's got that ultra blue color, and I snuck our logo on the side while nobody was watching. So you know it's blue, but you can see blue color, it makes this look black. But if you use other blues and put more blue in it, you can get a blue kind of hue to the composite. But if you string that out with a modified acrylic, you can get that braid look to it. You can start seeing that herringbone pattern in there. And you can tell it's not dried out. All my edges are good. I'm not fuzzing or fraying anywhere. But that 222 layup that we send out with our composite samples in our rolls of composite, 2 flex of stretch, 2 nylon stockinette, 2 layers of braid, makes a really nice sock. It still has a little bit of movement to it, but that's a real good starting point for a standard layup. And we're ready to put our components in, clean it up, and she's down the road. So we were talking earlier about taking layers away to keep this line thinner looking. The more layers you have on it, the wider that makes this line right here. And the way I buffed it today and the way I sanded it, I actually exposed more of it than I needed to. Something we found out, especially when it's looking kind of black, take a black China marker and rub that China marker, this is a kind of a tech tip, onto that surface and then wipe it down with a rag or a paper towel, and you can black that back out and almost hide it from what it was to where it is now. That showing up on the video? The other thing a China marker does is it's kind of a clay-based marker. It reminds me of those crayons you use on furniture to hide scratches. So now, if you say you had a layup on here that was real heavy, and when you sanded that open, it just had, you know, a really wide opening on the outside edge where you sanded it. There's one little quick way of maybe making it look a little cleaner. And you get that clay on this, and it makes that edge just baby smooth. I mean, you don't even feel anything. It's just like the outside of the lamination is how it feels with that little bit of oil in it. Maybe you drop it on the bench and it gets a scuff in it somewhere, and it's like, oh man, everything's perfect. It's got this one little scratch. Sometimes you can do that and wipe it in there to help hide that scratch. Anyway, just a tech tip. So we're talking about finishing the edges. We were over at the Troutman and doing our little China marker trick and blacking that out. Makes it look a little nicer. If you're having trouble with your edge still and you're running on a slow wheel and you've tried Tycro, if you've tried a Scotch-Brite wheel and you're just not quite happy with the way that feels on the edge, use our other technique that we've put in our website, and that's taking the Scotch-Brite pad, getting it wet, and go ahead and lightly hand sand that edge. And that little Scotch-Brite will just make that sandpaper just, you know, smoother, smoother, softer, softer, and just makes that edge even nicer. Right now what I've got, what I just did, is great. You can wear that all day long. But if you need it even better, go ahead, do the wetting it and the wet sand with the Scotch-Brite, and it'll make that edge even nicer. So we're ready for our lock. Everything's cleaned. We've got our lock assembly here. It only goes in one way. First two springs are your entrance. You can see them going in. No springs are falling. Nice and smooth. All right. So we'll go ahead, hold that with a little tension in our thumb. We'll take our pin, run it in there just to hold it in place. So nothing falls out, that just held that lock plate in. And we'll drop our second spring in, or third spring, excuse me, right there in the center. Hand start that, hand tighten it, that feels good. Okay, we wrench this down. And that's the other thing too, when you go to wrench these on, you don't have to get in there and torque on it. Just bring it down snug, and you can feel that O-ring seating in. That's plenty tight enough right there. And we'll check it to make sure we've got good placements. Beautiful. Can't pull it out. Push the button, it releases. Perfect. That is one good looking socket right there.